So yesterday we discussed the behavior of an inverter and then the propagation delay of a single inverter. And now we have a look at the power consumption. Again, some of the things that I will discuss today are already known to you from previous classes. Some of them are new. Before going into the calculation of the various factors adding to the total power consumption, let we have a look again at the transfer characteristics of a MOSFET. So yesterday I have written the expression of the IV characteristics for a MOSFET in the various bias conditions, and we can now plot them in the transfer characteristics, which means the I, the S as a function of VGS for a constant VDS. We take VDS equal to VDD, the supply voltage. And in this situation, since VDS is the highest available voltage in the digital circuit, basically we can only be in two of the three possible bias conditions, either in the off state or in saturation. And of course, the distinction between the two bias conditions is given by VGS. We consider an NMOS transistor, so if VGS is smaller than VTN, the device is off, and this means that the current is zero. So we write something EDS equal to zero. For VGS larger than VTN, we are in saturation, and as you know, EDS depends quadratically on the overdrive, which is VGS minus VTN. So we have a parabola. So this is IDS equal to KN over 2 times the overdrive to the second power. Okay. By definition, the current that we have when VGS is equal to the supply voltage, VDD, here, is called ION, the ON current, ION. This is just a definition. So ION is the current that we have when VDS is equal to VGS, which is also equal to the supply voltage. Okay. You should keep in mind that these transfer characteristics are approximated. Okay, there are strong approximations. First of all, this part of the characteristics in saturation is not actually a quadratic expression, is something more or less intermediate between a linear expression and the quadratic expression in practice. And most importantly, the current in the off state is not zero. Okay, on this scale it appears as negligible, because basically you cannot separate it from the x-axis, but it is actually not zero. And this aspect is very important for the discussion on the power consumption that we will have. If we want to, let's say, highlight the current in the off state, we need to use a semi-log scale, which means that on the y-axis we need to use the logarithm of IDS, so normalized over a certain I0, so that we have a log scale here, and we can use the linear scale on the x-axis, again VGS. So when you have linear scale on one axis and log scale on the other axis, you have a semi-log plot. What's the behavior on this semi-log plot? You have something like this. Basically, we have aligned the axis, so this is VTN also on this scale. The threshold voltage. And then in saturation, you have something like this. So this would be ION, and this would be VDD. Okay, and in the off state you have a line. Basically you have a line like this. Of course, as you can easily understand, a line in the semi-log scale means an exponential curve on the linear scale. So in the off scale, we have a current that increases exponentially with VDS. It's very low, so on the linear scale it seems like zero, but it is not. So in let's discuss a bit this behavior. This is exponential. Basically, in this region, we have in the off state, we have that the current is proportional. IDS in the off state is proportional to the exponential of VGS over, of course, the argument of the exponential must be a pure number, so we need to have a voltage here. We can write something like this, N times VTH. So the current is proportional to the exponential of VGS. This VTH is the thermal voltage. So it is KT over Q, and it's a number which is 26 millivolts at 300K. You have already met. Okay, I understand that I must not draw in the bottom part of the screen. Okay, so this is the last time I will do that. Anyway, the thermal voltage is KT over Q. You have already encountered this expression. K is the Boltzmann constant, T is the absolute temperature in Kelvin, and Q is the elementary electron charge. K and Q are universal constant. T of course not. T is the temperature. It is a quantity which is proportional to the temperature, so it is sufficient that you know one point. At 300K, which means room temperature, it is 27 Celsius degrees, the thermal voltage has a value of 26 millivolt. Okay. This other number, N, is a pure number. It is close to 1. It's something like 1.1, 1.2, depending on the particular device geometry. Okay. So you can for the moment consider that it's something close to 1. It's enough, right? it's not important to have a precise idea of the number. Okay, let me use another sheet. Okay, for your convenience, I will draw again the transfer characteristics. So we have 0, we have VDD, and this is VTN. On the x-axis we have VGS. Here we have the current IDS on a log scale. Okay. We have something like this here, and then this line. Okay, just to put some definitions here, we have this current is ion, and on the other hand we can define also the IOF, which is this one. This is called IOF. So IOF is the current between drain and source, so it is by definition IDS when VDS is equal to VDD and VGS is equal to 0. So the device is in the is in the off state. And this is also called leakage current, because let me write in leakage current. In Italian it would be corrente di perdita, because it's a current that you don't want but still you have, because of course the channel is not completely off. It's never completely off. Why that current is important? Because of course since when the MOSFET is off, you have that current, you have some power dissipation also when the MOSFET is off. There's also an additional current component that you have to consider that is important for other reasons. Let's assume that you are in the situation of IOF. Basically you have here VDD, the source is at 0, so it is at ground, and then you have the gate at 0, again at ground. You have a voltage between drain and gate. In principle you have an insulator between the gate and the channel, so you do not have current across the insulator, and then you do not have a current through the gate terminal, but in practice you have some, because the insulator is not a perfect insulator, and then you have some leakage also through the gate. So you have to consider also the possibility that you have some current through the insulator. We can call it IG. IG is the gate leakage current. So you have IOF, which is this one, and IG. In this situation, when the transistor should be off and therefore should consume zero power, actually you have something, and we can write the type of power that it is consuming, because you have a VDD voltage applied here, so you have a generator at a voltage VDD, and the total current that this generator is providing is the sum of IOF plus IG. So you have a power consumption which is called static power, which is VDD times IOF plus IG. We can call it we can call this sum IOF prime, so that we can use simple expression VDD times IOF prime. Okay. That part is very small, because those currents are in most cases negligible. The problem is that for large chips you have so many transistors that at some point the sum of this current overall the transistors become significant, and this type of current is actually the most important contribution to the standby power of a device, which basically determines the duration of the, which determines the battery life in practice. So it's become extremely important. So I started from the static power because it is the new part, but of course you know that there is another component of the power dissipation of a CMOS circuit, which is the most important one, you already know it, is the dynamic power. And let's briefly consider it again in order to have a complete picture of the situation. Let's look at the dynamic power. Dynamic power consumption. So the static power is the power dissipated when the FET is not switching, is in static conditions. The dynamic power is the power dissipated when the CMOS is switching, and actually it is proportional to the number of switching per second. So in order to evaluate the dynamic power consumption, we first evaluate the total energy dissipated per each switch, and then we multiply by the times the gate switches per second. Okay. As an example of a logic gate, we consider the inverter for simplicity, but the same considerations would apply for any other logic gate. We have done all our calculations for the inverter, and we continue in this way. This is VDD, this is the output, and this is the input. We have to consider that we have a capacitance as a load applied to the inverter. The same that we have considered for the same capacitance that we have considered for the propagation delay. So it is exactly the same thing. Now let's assume that we have a complete cycle. So V out goes from 0 to VDD, and it's gonna take some time, and then again goes from VDD to 0. This is time. So in the first transition you have that the voltage on the capacitance has to go from 0 to VDD, and in order to do that you have to charge the capacitance through the PMOS. Okay, so this is what happens during A. During A, we can compute different energy quantities. The energy from the provided by the supply voltage, let's write provided by the supply voltage. You can see this charge that goes into the capacitance comes from the supply voltage across the PMOS. So this energy has to be computed by integrating VDD times IT over the charging time during charge. Let's write it here A in order to remember that we are integrating during the charging time. Of course, this becomes VDD times the integral of the current, which is the total charge which is accumulated on the capacitance. And we already know the value because the capacitance at the end has a voltage VDD, so it has a charge which is C times VDD. So this is C VDD, which is C VDD square. So this energy is provided by the supply voltage generator. Of course, we know the energy stored in the capacitance. This is a simple calculation. It is 1/2 C VDD square. And the difference between the first energy and the second energy is some energy which has been dissipated in mostly in the PMOS. So it's some energy which has basically been transformed in heat. Okay, as a result of this energy dissipation, we have a warmer PMOSFET. So dissipated energy . So the difference between the two is the other half of the total energy provided by the power supply. So during the charge, the power supply provides some energy. Half of this energy is transformed into heat, and half of this energy is stored in the capacitance. Okay. Then we have the other phase, phase B. I have some space here, and in phase B we have something different. Of course, in this phase the PMOS is off, but the NMOS is conducting, because during phase B Vin is equal to VDD, because we are putting a high voltage on the input in order to have a low voltage on the output. And then we have this path for the charge. Basically, what happens is that we have a complete discharge of the output capacitance, of the load capacitance, through the NMOS. Okay, this is what is happening. And you can see that the PMOS is off, so the voltage supply is not interested in this charge transfer, is not providing any additional energy to the system. So generator provides no energy, and the energy that was stored on the capacitance is completely dissipated in the NMOS. Because at the end of the discharge, the energy stored in the capacitance is zero, because the voltage on the capacitance is zero. And this means that all the energy that was stored in the capacitance becomes transformed into heat. is dissipated in the NMOS, right? So I can write here energy dissipated in the energy dissipated, no, let me write dissipated energy as before. Dissipated energy is 1/2 C VDD squared. Okay. Okay, I can write here the conclusions. The total energy dissipated in a complete cycle, total energy per cycle, is 1/2 C VDD. No, sorry, is C the sum of the two. So 1/2 plus 1/2 is 1 C VDD squared. So basically, at the end of a cycle, we are in the initial conditions, which means that all the energy provided by the generator has been dissipated into heat. Okay, this is something you know. There are some additional details to stress. And the first is this one. When we have this switching, actually, for a moment, the two for a short interval of time, the two transistors are in the on state at the same time. So in addition to that part, to that contribution to the current, we also have some current which directly goes from the voltage generator to the ground, and this is again provided by the generator. I can draw this contribution in blue, let's say in Chan. So basically we have this current directly from VDD to ground. If you remember the transfer characteristics of an inverter, you remember we drew this yesterday. Basically we have V out as a function of V in, and the curve was something like this. This was VDD, then we had this part, then this part, then this part, and then this part, and this was VDD again. So in this situation, when VDD is high and V out is low, we are in one of the two let's say stable bias point of the inverter. For example, let's call it Vout is zero, let's call this point zero. So we are here. In this point instead, in this part, central part, we have that Vout is equal to VDD and Vin is equal to zero. So we are in this part. So when the inverter goes from 0 to 1, it has to pass through this central region of the IV characteristics, in which we have seen that both transistors are in the off state. So they are both letting current pass through, and therefore we have power consumption. What is this? We can compute this power consumption like this. Basically we have VDD, which is the voltage of the generator, times the current that passes directly, let's call it ID, the current. This is current in series between in series through the two transistors. this is a function of time because of course it varies, and we have to integrate over time. So this v times this v times I is a power. If we integrate it in time, is an energy. So I have to change. This is not the power per switching, this is the energy. Yeah, an additional contribution to the energy dissipated per switching. So let's call it ES. So energy dissipated per switching during switch. This is an additional contribution independent of the charging and discharging of the load capacitance. And if you compute it, is something like VDD times one can write here a certain I average during switching time a certain T switching. Basically, this I times T switching is the integral of the current in time. Okay. And this happens twice. One for the switching, let's say from 1 to 0, and once for the switching from 0 to 1. So if we compute the total energy per switching, per cycle, we have C VDD square times twice E switching. We have to consider also this contribution. Now, for the moment, this term is negligible with respect to the first one. And this has been the reason for the success of CMOS technology. Because when CMOS technology was introduced, it was the late 70s, the main reason was that it had a low power consumption. Because in practice, the second term was negligible with respect to VDD, with respect to the first one, to CVDD square, and the static power consumption was negligible. At the time, for the technology of the 70s, those two contributions were negligible, and the only significant contribution was this CVDD square. Then things changed, and up to now things have changed a lot. And now we discuss a bit. So this is the energy. From the energy we have to compute the dynamic power dissipation, but of course that is easy, because basically what you do is, okay, I can have the energy dissipated per cycle, and I have to multiply this energy by the time, the number of cycles that I have for any second. And this is something which is proportional to the clock frequency. So I can multiply this times the clock frequency. And since a single gate does not switch for any clock period, we can also add an additional factor, which is a number smaller than one, that is called activity factor. Which is basically the ratio of the time you have the switching per second over the clock frequency. So in the end, this is the number. If we want to summarize this concept, for the whole chip, we have a dynamic power consumption which is the sum of this contribution over all logic gates. So basically you see that all the terms are constant except for C, so we can write something like C tot, the total capacitance of the integrated circuits, which is the sum of the capacitances at the output of all logic gates, times VDD square times F clock times the activity factor. And then we have a static power consumption, which is again the sum of the static power over all logic gates. So we have VDD times I of prime over all transistors. So one can write it something like let's write it total, the sum of the current over all transistors. And of course the total power consumption is the sum of the two. Now, as we have done yesterday, let's make some considerations. These are easy formulas, but it's important to grasp the meaning of these expressions for the evolution of the semiconductor industry and of all the chip industry. And you will see that even if these are very simple formulas, they have a great impact of what is what has happened in the last 20 years at least. So first of all, let's consider the dependence on the supply voltage. We have seen yesterday that the supply voltage has an impact on the propagation delay. If you remember, the larger the supply voltage, the smaller the propagation delay, and therefore the faster you can go. But it also has an impact on the power consumption, because you can see here that even if you keep the clock frequency constant, the dynamic power is proportional to VDD square. Okay. And also the static power is depends on VDD. Okay. How does it depend? At first we can say it is proportional, but it is not true, because you have to remember, if I take something from the IV characteristics here, this I off depends on the this I off depends on the voltage between drain and source. I wrote it here. If you look, you see? No, you don't see here. Okay, no. No, this is not the proper place. No, I have to add something. Okay. Let me write something slightly. Depends. Depends on VDD, also I off, but but for the moment let's not consider this aspect. It's more complicated than this. Let's not consider it now. So let's summarize a bit because we have to finish. So PD is proportional to VDD square. PD is also proportional to F clock. This is something we know. And it is also something we are prepared for, because of course the faster we want to go, the more power we have to spend. Okay, let me see if there is anything else I should add now. No, probably we don't have time to put the two things together. Okay, so we stop here. What we are going to do next time is putting together the considerations we have done here on the power and the consideration we have done on the propagation delay to see the impact on the evolution of the semiconductor technology. Let's stop it here for the moment.